the essential aspect of shamanic practice in the way that it relates to siddhic practice is there is this effort to go beyond the physical forms that surround us and to understand what are the more subtle aspects of reality and how are they affecting our material experience. And in shamanic cultures, the shaman is the one who's in charge of bringing that the power that is in this unseen world into the affairs of those who are that the shaman serves. Now, in terms of siddhic practice, now siddhas, I actually think that, you know, the original siddhas were of course shamans because we are creatures of nature. We are trying to understand the powers of nature. But in siddhic cultures, which are primarily the cultures that are in South Asia, although you have, of course, other traditions that have similar kinds of practices, the siddhas are referent to, or the word siddha is referent to, the cultures that are in South Asia, which whose practitioners are also interested in understanding the unseen qualities of experience that are affecting the physical experience. But from my perspective, and again, we can talk about this, there's many different ways of understanding this, but from my perspective, one of the big differences between shamanic practice and siddhic practice is that siddhic practice is primarily individual. The siddhas who are trying to, and also siddhas are more focused on understanding the nature of the self and the evolution of human consciousness and there, and by association, the nature of consciousness in general. And there's this idea there's a more, generally more focused practice on understanding one's own experience, understanding how one's own experience is related to the divine, and then resting in that, in those practices for one's self. Siddhas are often, you know, they often have hermit-like practices. They are often apart from the culture that they are working in because they are moving beyond the physical forms and moving into the subtle study of the subtle energies that are driving physical forms or that physical forms are in relationship to. So this is a big difference because shamans have their own individual practices, but they are primarily focused on serving the community that they're in. So you have these two wisdom systems. Both are very interested in understanding the subtle energies that are driving physical form, but they have different focus. The shaman is understanding primarily the powers of nature and the unseen powers behind the physical forms of nature and is interested in bringing that power into human affairs. And the siddhas are interested in understanding the subtle forces that are driving consciousness. They're interested in understanding how personal consciousness evolves and what that evolution of personal consciousness is in relationship to the larger field of experience of the divine. So, and this is primarily for individual elucidation and is primarily dedicated to the siddha's own spiritual practice. So this is a description of the two general systems and talking about that those two similarities and those two differences that I just mentioned. Now, there's a few other similarities that I'd like to go into and a few other differences that I'd like to go into. Both traditions focus on the movement of energy or power from one place to another. And I have to tell you, I'm a little bit sloppy, and I shouldn't be, when I'm talking about power and energy. Sometimes I use them interchangeably. In general, when I speak about power, I'm speaking about universal power, and the source of all of the different expressions of energy that that take different forms on a physical level. And when I talk about energy exchanges, I talk about that step down of universal power that people or animals are using, or plants are using, to create communication and to create bonds and to create an environment. So that is not separate from the power of the universal field, but is differentiated and defined in its differentiation between the in the way that energy is exchanged. So both traditions focus on the movement of energy and power from one place to another. In shamanic practice, you have the shaman directing universal power into, like, for instance, a healing situation. There's a form of imbalance that is defined in shamanic practice that is called power loss. And its symptoms are, you know, loss of energy, depression, anxiety. Power loss is at the heart of most addictions. Most addictions are an effort to ameliorate power loss. And so what the shaman would do is to, in order to ameliorate power loss, the shaman would go outside of time, find the source of power in the universal field, and bring it back in to the individual's energy system to help ameliorate the power loss. Okay? So that's an example of the movement of energy from one place to another. For siddhas, of course, the siddhas are more interested in, you know, how can I track the energy flows within my own system, what affects those energy flows, and if I'm working with these energy flows within my own system, which one of those, or which way of working with this energy connects me to the universal field more effectively, and what's the nature of that connection, right? So there's an example. Both systems use ritual to direct power from one place to another. And I'm hoping that we're going to have some time to give you some experiential instruction on the way that ritual works. Both use the process of initiation to create a ladder for skill development. And again, I'm really hoping that we're going to have time to talk about the nature of initiation and the way that initiatory processes mediate the generation of new forms that are there, that are better able to hold power. Do you have a question?
I was wondering if there's a bathroom in here.
Oh yeah, right there. Good to know. Good to know. So both use the process of initiation to create a ladder for skill development, and the process of initiation is a process whereby old forms fall away and new forms are created from the power that is released as those old forms fall away. And we're going to, I hope, have time to really go in more into the nature of this process of change and creative catalytic experience that is at the heart of being able to build greater capacity to understand one's own individual energy and to understand its relationship to the universal field. And then if one were to have a more shamanic view, then how to dedicate that knowledge to the community. Right. So, and both work with elements, and elements, and when I'm speaking of the elements, I'm speaking of earth, water, fire, and air as a basis, and there are some shamanic traditions that also work with space, metal, and wood, and some work, you know, and some work with just space, and some work with space and wood and metal. You know, so anyway, you'll find, you know, but the big four are always present in some form or another, especially in their representation in the rituals, in both traditions. So, and the understanding of the way that elements work together to form and generate material reality is fundamental to shamanic practice and to siddhic practice. This study is very important. In the classes that I teach in the Applied Shamanism program at the Sacred Stream, we look at elements, actually we look at elements in the Applied Shamanism, we look at them in the energy medicine classes, and we look at them in the depth hypnosis classes. There is so much to learn about the activity of elements. We probably won't have time to go into that study, but the important thing to know is that both systems draw a tremendous amount of knowledge from understanding the elements. Also, both systems work with light and sound for accessing deeper understanding. So there's, you know, within Siddhic traditions, you have you often find in many Siddhic traditions, you have this emphasis on the use of the breath and the way that the breath can carry light and the way that the breath carries sound and the way in which light and sound affects the processes of consciousness. And in shamanic practice, light and sound are fundamental carriers of universal power. And you will see in most shamanic practices, there's the use of the drum or this chanting or some other kind of sound that becomes like a highway for universal power to move into ordinary reality. So both systems work extensively with the elements, with the light, and with the sound. So the general similarities, to summarize, are both focus on the movement of power and energy from one place to another. Both use the process of ritual to direct power from one place to another. Both use the processes of initiation to create a ladder for skill development. And both work with the elements, light and sound as a basis for developing understanding. And we're going to be hopefully touching all of those similarities in our learning. The general differences I've already mentioned, shamanic practice is more service oriented to the community. Siddha practice is more oriented toward individual liberation. We've already covered that. Shamanic views a shamanic practitioner will often view the movement of energy and power as arising outside of the self. That there's this idea, there's this reification of energy and power as outside of the self, and the shaman is often interacting with it in the process of doing divinations or healings or other practices they might be asked to do. Siddhic practice views the movement of power and energy as arising from within the self. So it's much more intra-psychic. These are subtle differences, but they're huge differences. So there's extra-psychic and intra-psychic. Extra-psychic is, even though you're in non-ordinary reality, you're already deep within the self when you're doing shamanic practices, the phenomenon that are arising within the practice are viewed as being outside of the self. in terms of like a meditation or a journey. And with intra-psychic, with siddhic practice, it's understood that anything that is arising as part of one's investigation is part of oneself, are different aspects of one's own being. So very, very interesting. Both ways of seeing the world offer wonderful insight. There's a difference between them. And okay, so then in the shamanic worldview, and again, this is a worldview that you find in almost all shamanic cultures, the worldview is held in the idea of the three worlds, the upper world, the middle world, and the lower world. And you can see this is an echo of the ordinary reality that we're experiencing right now, where we have the sky, the earth, and below the earth, right? But the inner cosmography of shamanic practice describes different types of beings that inhabit these different worlds. And in shamanic practice, and again, this is interesting that you see this arising in different cultures from around the world in a very similar way. The upper world and the lower world are places where fields of energy that are described as spirits are found. And the spirits that are found in the upper and lower worlds are considered to be compassionate in nature. And the experience that is reported, anecdotal experience across millennia, support the experience of only compassionate beings in the upper and lower world. In the middle world, which is this world where we are right now, there's the ordinary aspect of it where we are, and then the non-ordinary aspect of it. And in this place, you find beings that are compassionate in nature, but you also find beings that are not compassionate in nature. And in shamanic practice, the shamans, now, there is a huge range of shamanic practice. I focus in my teachings and in my practice, I focus only on shamanic practices that increase well-being. Okay. So you're always working when you're working in to help heal or do divinations or understand the nature of plants, to figure out what's happening with the soul that has passed and is not continuing on its journey, you're working in the middle world shamanically. So although the shaman's education is established first with the compassionate spirits in the upper and lower world, the actual work that the shaman does is in the middle world, because the shaman is serving the community. And you have everyone existing here in the middle world, and then you have the unseen powers that are affecting experience in the middle world that the shaman seeks to address in order to bring, again, the practices that I teach, positive change. Okay. So this emphasis on the middle world you find in shamanic practice. In siddhic practice, you find the emphasis on, I wish I could use this word in English, au-delà. I studied comparative religion in Institut Catholique de Paris, and I had this wonderful professor, his Jungian guy, and he would always say, the au-delà, le au-delà. And the au-delà means that which is beyond, right? You know, it's like this general, you know, indication of the world beyond, and it just doesn't hold it in English, you know. So the siddhas are investigating the au-delà, right? So they're investigating the worlds beyond and of course it's not necessarily external, it's the internal experience of the transcendence. So and the focus is in many siddhic practices you have this like flight away from the middle. You know, you have a lot of ascetic practices, you know, where they're actually trying to like squeeze all the life out of the body to see if they can get more spiritual, right? Buddha found out that didn't work. So I don't know why they're still trying, but anyway. I guess they want to find out for themselves, which is fine. So there's this shamanic, so that in Siddha practice, there's this investigation of transcendent reality, and the focus is more on that transcendence and experience of transcendence and the movement into transcendence, whereas in shamanic practice, the movement is more toward the understanding of the unseen powers as they are operating in the middle world. Okay. Then the last difference that I'd like to articulate between the two of them is that shamanic practice has a primary focus in understanding the power of the natural world. This is where shamans are focused. They want to understand the power in the natural world. Siddha practice has a primary focus on understanding the power of the universal flow or the ground luminosity. Okay? Big, big difference. The focus of instruction for the shaman is the earth herself, and the focus for instruction for siddhas is primarily the universal flow. Of course, we can say they are not that different, but on the outside they look different, right? They're different access points, right? So again, I'm going to go over the general differences. Shamanic practice is more service-oriented to the community. Siddha practice is more oriented toward individual liberation. Shamanism views the movement of energy and power as outside of the self. Siddha practice views the movement of energy and power as arising from within the self. Shamanic practices focus on the middle world or on mundane events. And Siddha practice focuses on upper or lower world or supra-mundane events. Shamanic practice has a primary focus on understanding the power of the natural world. And Siddha practice has a primary focus for understanding the power of the universal flow or ground luminosity. And this expression, ground luminosity, for those of you that are Buddhist practitioners, the ground luminosity is something you already know about. This is the essential clear light that is at the heart of all experience. So there's my lecture on the two systems, definitions of the two systems, and then comparing the similarities and the differences between them. Does anyone have any questions or comments on anything that I've discussed so far before we head into looking more at shamanic practice?